Hello everyone, myself Dr. M. Srijan Kumar. My education background is pharmacy. We have been dealing with a topic called as WHO guideline for assessment of herbal drugs. Already the first session has been completed. This particular session is in continuation with your first session. If you want to understand this session, please go through my first session, which has been already published in YouTube. Yeah. In the first session, we have discussed with some assessment parameters like powder fineness and seed size, general advice on sampling, determination of foreign matter, macroscopic and microscopic examination, thin layer chromatography. Okay, we have discussed these assessment parameters in first session. Let us move on to the remaining assessment parameters. Coming to the next parameter, determination of ash. The ash remaining following ignition of herbal materials is determined by three different methods, which measure total ash, acid insoluble ash, and water soluble ash. Now the herbal material is subjected to ignition. After ignition, what will be remain? Ash will be remain. That particular ash will be determined by three different methods. Why three different methods? Because three different types of ashes will be remained. One is total ash, the other one is acid insoluble ash, the other one is water soluble ash. Okay, so how this total ash will be determined, how this acid insoluble ash will be determined, how this water soluble ash will be determined, let us see. Going on to the first one, the total ash method is designed to measure total amount of material remaining after ignition. As we said that herbal material is subjected for ignition. After ignition, what is the total amount of material present? Okay, that will give you the result for your total ash determination. So here two types of ashes will be present in that remained ash. One is physiological ash, the other one is non-physiological ash. Okay, what do you mean by physiological ash? Anything that is derived from the plant tissue itself is called as physiological ash. Anything which is a residue of the extraneous matter like sand and soil adhering to the plant surface, it is called as non-physiological ash. Okay. Next, acid insoluble ash is the residue obtained after boiling the total ash with dilute hydrochloric acid and igniting the remaining insoluble matter. Okay, so acid insoluble ash is nothing but the residue. Okay, how you are going to get this residue? This residue is obtained after subjecting your total ash with your dilute hydrochloric acid. After treating your total ash with your dilute hydrochloric acid, and again you need to go for igniting. Okay, the remaining insoluble matter. On igniting the remaining insoluble matter, whatever residue that is obtained, that is nothing but your acid insoluble ash. So what it will measure? It will measure the amount of silica present, especially something that is confined to sand and siliceous earth. Okay, what it will measure? Your acid insoluble ash will measure what? Silica present, amount of silica present that is confined to your sand and siliceous earth. Coming to the water soluble ash. What is water soluble ash? It is the difference in weight between the total ash and the residue after treatment of total ash with water. It is the difference in weight between what and what? Between your total ash and the residue after treatment of total ash with water. The difference in weight will give you water soluble ash. Okay, that's all about your determination of ash content. Yeah, next parameter is determination of extractable matter. This method determines the amount of active constituents extracted with solvents from a given amount of herbal material. So what do you mean by this? Any herbal material should undergo what? Extraction process. Any extraction process you select, ultimately you will be using solvent to that. Okay. So what is the amount of active constituent extracted with the solvent need to be determined. Okay, So in order to determine this, this particular parameter comes into picture, determination of extractable matter. And this particular determination will be employed for herbal materials for which there is no suitable chemical or biological assay. Okay, that exists. Okay, what do you mean by that? That means that this particular determination of extractable matter will be applicable to such herbal materials where there is no suitable chemical or biological assay in monographs that is available. In such conditions, you will apply this. So hot extraction and cold maceration methods are employed for extractable matter determination. What are the two methods employed here? Hot extraction and cold maceration methods. Next, determination of water and volatile matter. Determination of water and volatile matter. This is the next parameter. An excess of water in herbal materials will encourage microbial growth, the presence of fungi or insects, and deterioration following hydrolysis. Any preparation you take, whenever there is a presence of water, ultimately it will degrade the formulation. Here, it is same in your herbal material extraction process. When there is some excess of water in herbal material, it will encourage what? Microbial growth. Okay. Also, the presence of fungi or insects. Okay. Not only microbial growth, it also encourages the presence of fungi and or insects. And by that, it will just result in deterioration following the process called as hydrolysis. Okay. So, limits for water content should therefore be set for every given herbal material. Any herbal material you select for formulation aspects, so you need to check with what are the limits for water content. Okay, that limits for water content should be set for every given herbal material. This is especially important for materials that absorb moisture easily or deteriorate quickly in presence of water. Okay, if you see n number of herbal materials that are present, out of which there are some herbal materials which are sensitive to moisture. That means that these herbal materials will easily absorb moisture. On absorption of moisture, they will deteriorate quickly in presence of water. So here there are two methods employed for the determination of water and volatile matter. The one is azeotropic method. This azeotropic method gives a direct measurement of the water present in the material being examined. This azeotropic method, it will give a direct measurement of the water that is present in the material being examined. What is this azeotropic method? We'll see in the next slide. Yeah, when the sample is distilled together with an immiscible solvent, that means nothing, a sample is nothing but your herbal material, is distilled together with an immiscible solvent, such as the solvent here is toluene R or xylene R. R is nothing but reference solvent. Okay, toluene R or xylene R. The water present in the sample is absorbed by the solvent. Okay, it's a very simple process. Take your herbal material. That herbal material should be distilled with an immiscible solvent. The solvent such as your toluene R and xylene R. The water that is present in the sample, that is nothing but your herbal material, is absorbed by the solvent. Thereby, you can determine your presence of water. Next, the test for loss on drying. I said two tests. Azeotropic method is the one to determine water, and loss on drying is the another method. The test for loss on drying determines both water and volatile matter. Azeotropic method will determine only on water, but loss on drying will determine both your water and volatile matter. How? Drying can be carried out either by heating to 100 to 105 degrees. Here you need to dry the material. It can be carried out either by heating to 100 to 105 degree centigrade, or you can also subject your herbal material to a desiccator over phosphorus pentoxide reference material, phosphorus pentoxide, under atmospheric or reduced pressure at room temperature for specified period of time. So two types of drying you can do, either subjecting your material at 100 to 105 degrees or subjecting your material to a desiccator containing your phosphorus pentoxide R under atmospheric or reduced pressure, subjecting to a room temperature for a specific period of time. You can determine both water and your volatile matter. Okay, the desiccation method is especially useful for materials that melt to a sticky mass at elevated temperatures. So when you are going to employ this desiccator method, this desiccator method will be employed in such conditions where your herbal material that melt to a sticky mass at elevated temperature. So in such conditions, you can go for subjecting your herbal material to desiccation for determination of loss on drying. Okay, next, determination of volatile oils. Next parameter is determination of volatile oils. Volatile oils are characterized by their odor, oil-like appearance and ability to volatile at room temperature. Volatile oils, how you are going to characterize your volatile oils? Either by their odor, oil-like appearance or ability to volatilize at room temperature. By these three characteristics, you can determine, yeah, volatile oil is present in that herbal material. Because they are considered to be the essence of the herbal material and are often biologically active, they are also known as essential oils. Okay, these particular herbal materials are recognized by their essence. Okay, and it not only giving essence to the herbal material, that particular volatile oil present in the herbal material is often biologically active. Okay, that volatile oils are also called as essential oils. The term volatile is preferred because it is more specific and describes the physical properties. Okay, when you say volatile oil, okay, why you are going to use the term volatile oil? Because it's a specific term and this particular volatile oil will impart physical properties to your herbal material. In order to determine the volume of oil, the plant material is distilled with water and the distillate is collected in a graduated tube. Now going on to the determination of your volatile oils. So in order to determine what is the volume of oil present, first what you need to do, the plant material should be, like your herbal material, should be distilled with water and the obtained distillate is collected in a graduated tube. The aqueous portion separates automatically and is returned to the distillation flask. Okay, what happens when you just transfer to a graduated tube? The aqueous portion, whatever that is present, it separates automatically and again it is returned to the distillation flask. If the volatile oils possess a mass density higher than or near to that of water, are difficult to separate from the aqueous phase owing to the formation of emulsions. So during this distillation process and all, if your volatile oil possess a mass density higher than or near to the water, what happens here? It is difficult to separate from the aqueous phase. So when it is difficult to separate from the aqueous phase, what happens here? It will result in the formation of emulsion. So here what we need to do, a solvent with a low mass density and a suitable boiling point may be added to the measuring tube. To that measuring tube, you need to select a solvent with low mass density and that particular solvent having a character called as boiling point, suitable boiling point, should be added to your measuring tube. The dissolved volatile oils will then float on top of the aqueous phase. Here what happens, there will be inversion. The dissolved volatile oils now start floating on the top of the aqueous phase. Thereby you can go for separation. Okay, this is the determination of volatile oils. Next, coming to the determination of bitterness value. Determination of bitterness value. Herbal materials that have a strong bitter taste are employed therapeutically mostly as appetizing agents. Okay, there are different types of herbal materials that are available, right? So under that, if any herbal material which is having a strong bitter taste, okay, they are employed therapeutically to the patient, okay, mostly as appetizing agents. Okay, what do you mean by appetizing agent? Which will increase the appetite, which will stimulate the appetite, nothing but called as appetizing agents. Their bitterness stimulates secretions in the gastrointestinal tract, especially of gastric juice. Okay, what is the mechanism here? When you administer this herbal material, which are having strong bitter taste, herbal material, when you administer this bitter material, will stimulate secretions in the gastrointestinal tract, especially of gastric juice, where thereby it will increase the appetite. Bitter substances can be determined chemically. These bitter substances can be determined chemically. However, since they are mostly composed of two or more constituents with various degree of bitterness, it is first necessary to measure total bitterness by taste. So, normally we said that bitterness can be determined chemically. If you say chemically, so here my question is, if you consider a herbal plant material, if this herbal plant material is producing bitterness, so you cannot say that one constituent is producing bitterness, because as I said, herbal plant material, it will contain many constituents. There are many constituents that are responsible for producing the bitterness. First, we need to measure total bitterness by the taste. Okay, because if one constituent is there, it's well and good, we can just determine it and we can just keep it aside. But here, two or more constituents that are responsible for various degree of bitterness. When you say various degree of bitterness, one shows less, one shows more, one shows medium. So here what we need to do, first we need to measure total bitterness by taste. The bitter properties of herbal material are determined by comparing the threshold bitter concentration of an extract of the material with that of dilute solution of quinine hydrochloride reference solution. Okay, so how you need to determine here? This can be determined by comparing the threshold bitter concentration between what and what? Between the extract of the material and dilute solution of quinine hydrochloride solution. Okay, you need to compare what? Threshold bitter concentration between extract of your herbal material and dilute solution of quinine hydrochloride R. The bitterness value is expressed in units equivalent to the bitterness of solution containing 1 gram of quinine hydrochloride R in 2000 ml. Okay, how the bitterness value can be expressed? It can be expressed in units that is equivalent to the bitterness of a solution containing 1 gram of quinine hydrochloride R in 2000 ml. So 1 gram of quinine hydrochloride should be taken and it should be added to the 2000 ml solution. Okay, after adding to that, that should be compared with the bitterness of your drug with your quinine hydrochloride solution. Okay, so in that way you need to measure the bitterness value. Okay, it has to be measured at the same time, it has to be expressed confined to your 1 gram of quinine hydrochloride R in 2000 ml. Okay, that's all about your determination of bitterness value. Next, determination of hemolytic activity. Determination of hemolytic activity. What do you mean by hemolysis? Rupture or destruction of RBC is called as hemolysis. Rupture or destruction of red blood cells is called as hemolysis. So what it is about, we'll see now. Many herbal materials, especially those derived from the families like Caryophyllaceae, Araliaceae, Sapindaceae, Primulaceae, Primulaceae and Dioscorace, this particular plant species will contain what? Saponins. It will contain what? Saponins. The most characteristic property of saponins is their ability to cause hemolysis. What is the characteristic property of saponins? It will result in hemolysis. When added to a suspension of blood, saponins produce change in erythrocyte membrane, causing hemoglobin to diffuse into the surrounding medium. When these saponins, when they are added to the suspension of blood, what saponins will do? They will change the erythrocyte membrane, that is nothing but rupturing your erythrocyte membrane, causing hemoglobin to diffuse into the surrounding medium. This is the mechanism of your saponin. Next, the hemolytic activity of herbal materials or a preparation containing saponins is determined by comparison with that of a reference material, saponin R, which has hemolytic activity of 1000 unit per gram. So, in order to determine hemolytic activity either for herbal material or for herbal preparations which contain saponins, so it can be determined by comparison with that of a reference material. Anything to be determined, that means your test substance, definitely we need to have reference material. Here the reference material used is saponin R, okay, which has hemolytic activity of 1000 units per gram. How much? 1000 units per gram. Now, a suspension of erythrocytes is mixed with equal volumes of serial dilution of herbal material extract. Now, you need to prepare serial dilutions of your herbal material extract, like 2 microgram per ml, 4, 6, 8 and 10. So, some serial dilutions of your herbal material extract should be prepared. To that, equal volumes of suspension of erythrocytes should be added. After adding this, now you need to check for the lowest concentration of your herbal material extract which causes complete hemolysis. Okay, this can be determined after subjecting your serial dilution herbal material extract for a specific period of time. After determining the lowest concentration, the same procedure, same dilution should be carried out for your reference material with saponin R. So, based upon the comparison, you can determine the saponin measurement. Okay, that's all about your determination of saponins. Next, determination of tannins. Determination of tannins. So, before going on to the determination, first we'll understand what do you mean by tannins. So, tannins are tanning substances capable of turning animal hides into leather. Animal hides, hides means nothing but animal skin into leather by binding proteins, by binding to the proteins to form water insoluble substances that are resistant to proteolytic enzymes. This is how your tannins will convert your animal skin to leather, okay, by binding to the specific proteins and converting into a water insoluble substance which are resistant to proteolytic enzymes. The same tannins, when they are applied to the living tissue like human body, human skin, these tannins will show a action called as astringent action. Okay, and this is the reason for therapeutic application of tannins. This is how your tannins, we just categorize tannins under a therapeutically active compound. Chemically, tannins are complex substances. They are usually occur as mixture of polyphenols that are difficult to separate and crystallize. Now coming to what are chemically what tannins are. Chemically, tannins are complex substances. Okay, they occur as mixtures of polyphenols. So as they occur as mixture of polyphenols, it is difficult to separate and recrystallize or crystallize. One more problem with the tannins is that these tannins will get easily oxidized and polymerized in a solution. If this happens, what happens? Ultimately, they lose their astringent effect and thereby they will produce little therapeutic value. Next parameter is determination of swelling index. One of the reasons for herbal materials to hold their specific therapeutic or pharmaceutical utility is due to their swelling properties. And what is the reason for swelling property? The swelling property is due to the gums and those containing an appreciable amount of mucilage, pectin or hemicellulose. So mucilage, pectin or hemicellulose are responsible for the herbal material to hold its swelling property. The swelling index is the volume in ml taken up by swelling of 1 gram of herbal material under specified condition. What do you mean by swelling index? It is the volume in ml taken by swelling of 1 gram of herbal material under specified conditions. So that means that 1 gram of herbal material should be soaked in desired solvent. After soaking in desired solvent in specified conditions, what is the ml where your 1 gram of herb can take? That is nothing but called as your swelling index. Its determination is based on the addition of water or a swelling agent as specified in the test procedure for each individual herbal material, either whole, cut or pulverized. So how you are going to determine the swelling index? It is based on addition of water or swelling agent as specified in the test procedure for each individual herbal material. So in order to determine swelling index, each individual herbal material having their specific monograph. So in that specific monograph, if they are saying to use water, you need to subject your herbal material to water. If they say that to add a swelling agent to the procedure, you need to add the swelling agent. So, and moreover, there are some instructions given about your herbal material, whether the herbal material should be used as a whole or it should be used in cut condition or it is used in a pulverized. Pulverized is nothing but in a powder form. So what is the setup here? Using a glass toppered measuring cylinder, you need to take a glass toppered measuring cylinder. Okay. The material is shaken repeatedly for 1 hour and then allowed to stand for required period of time. So you need to take a glass toppered measuring cylinder. To that you need to add your herbal drug substance. And after that you need to add water or swelling agent according to the test procedure. And after that you need to shake occasionally. Okay. And it should be kept for 1 hour. And then it is allowed to stand for required period of time. The volume of mixture in ml is then drained. So after specified period of time, according to the procedure given in the monograph, you need to just check what is the ml that has been consumed by the herb. That particular reading will give you your swelling index. That's all about today's session. Thank you. In the next session, we'll discuss with the remaining parameters. Thank you very much.